OTAN, Outreach and Technical Assistance Network.
Welcome, everyone. We are so excited to be here. For those of you who may have attended the CAPE Summit, you might have seen a session with Jay, Carol, and I earlier, later in 2021, previously, where we've started doing this kind of collaborative conversations and really talking about how do we make data and data usage a collaborative effort. And so we're going to dive into that a little bit more today, and we're going to talk about the purpose of data collaboration, and then I'm going to spend some time sharing some tools and different technology resources that are out there for you to use in data collaboration, and then Jay is going to finish us off with sharing some of his thoughts and resources that CASAS has available to us. So my name is Sudie Whalen. I'm with the California Adult Literacy Professional Development Project. I'm the Deputy Director of CALPRO, and I'm also a major tech nerd. This is literally my favorite conference every year, so I'm really happy to be here with you. Also on with me are Carol Hirota. Carol, would you like to introduce yourself real quickly?
Sure. Good morning. My name is Carol Hirota, and I'm a retired former administrator in Stockton School for Adults, and I'm currently working as a coach with the Targeted Technical Assistance with CAPE-TAP, and I'm happy to be here this morning. Thank you.
Thank you, Carol. And also on with us is Jay Wright, who most of us probably know, but we still want to have him introduce himself anyway.
I am Jay Wright from CASAS. And yeah, I think I recognize most of these names, but I'm Jay Wright from CASAS. I do a lot of trainings and network meetings up and down the state, mostly on Zoom, presumably the last couple of years, of course. Good to see you here this morning.
Thank you so much. So I'm going to go ahead and jump in. And so let's talk about kind of some of the reasons why we focus on data collaboration. First of all, it's really informative and helps us utilize data to inform our instruction, to differentiate instruction when needed, and really have concrete evidence of where we need to go in those areas. It also helps us improve instruction and programs based on data-driven decision-making. You can also utilize data to create actionable steps for your data teams. And Carol's going to talk to us more about what data teams are and what they do. Data also helps provide opportunities for teams to support each other. If you're working in a professional learning community or a data team, or just having collaborative conversations and want to develop shared meaning, collaborating on data is really helpful to add that additional level of support and understanding. Looking at the data specifically steers teams away from ineffective practices or procedures and moves us away from assumptions and into what does the data actually show us. It also improves consistency from one classroom or program to another when we're being intentional about focusing on what the data is showing us and closing gaps where we see them. It helps to guide future practice and inform teaching of specific skills if you're identifying areas that the data is showing you that certain competencies aren't being met and things of that nature. Lastly, it really supports a culture that uses evidence of student learning as an essential element for continuous improvement and not just, I know my students or this is what I think is happening, but utilizing that evidence. From an educator perspective, it really helps us in terms of student learning outcomes to differentiate instruction, provide interventions when needed, and promote when students are ready to move up. But it's also super helpful in terms of curriculum alignment. If you're aligning curriculum within your program from one level to the next, or if you're aligning curriculum within your consortium, looking at that data closely really helps us do that. So at this point, I'm going to go ahead and turn us over to Carol, and she's going to share with us why it helps to collaborate with colleagues on your data.
Thank you, Sudie. So with my experience at Stockton School for Adults, the question was, why would we want to collaborate with colleagues and not work in a silo? Well, the answer was basically accountability and continuous improvement. It was the theme of Kaizen, always improving, continuous improvement. So what we were expecting is that we wanted to collect accurate data. So that meant our data technicians, as well as our teachers and counselors, needed to ensure that the data that was put into the system was accurate. You know, you wanted to identify evidence of student outcomes. You could also identify gaps, barriers, trends, equity issues, student needs, and learner persistence. Those were some of the things when you were evaluating your data. You want to identify program and, more importantly, your student successes. And then establishing a culture of data is really critical so that people are not afraid to share the data from one person to another, teacher to teacher, you know, and the data technicians just saying, we want the most accurate data when we get it over to CASAS TE or making sure it's correct in our attendance system, but also developing a system of sharing and utilizing that data. So let's go to our next slide, Sudie. This is a chat. So what I'd like you to do is place in your chat, how does your agency currently collaborate on data? Can you just place it in chat? We'll give you a minute to do that. Any kind of collaboration. Okay, thank you. gather assessment data on a shared spreadsheet and use that data to inform planning for future units. Thank you, Richard. Quarterly data meetings. Awesome. There you go. Data-driven dialogues. At staff meetings, you share your data. Informally, fairly frequently, tied to reports, analyzing reports. Okay, those are all good ways where your agency can collaborate on data. Thank you for sharing all of that. Okay, perfect. So let's go on to the next slide, Sudie. It is, should be, in your chat now, indicate your role and your responsibilities at your agency with data collection and analysis. So based on your assigned role, what is your responsibility to collect that data collection and analysis? If you can place that in chat, please.
Maria is doing data collection and distribution of reports to appropriate staff.
Thank you, that's really critical. I know, Jay, you're always asked some questions with some of your data managers. I think Maria Elena's comment is very applicable. Managers of our team, we are a small team. So we get together to distribute the data and the responsibilities. Thank you. Okay, so let's go to the next slide. So whether you're working as a consortium or with your separate agencies, you know, the administrators, you know, like was reported, you're in charge of the whole system, you know, creating that culture, creating a system so that data is shared. You also have to make sure that your colleagues have all of the tools and resources necessary to be able to share their data. In other words, updated, you know, hardware and access to the software, you know, that it's not just one person has access, that maybe several people have access so that they're able to share that. And then of course, reviewing and analyzing the data with the team would be the administrator's responsibility. So the other one is the data managers. The data managers need to make sure that the data is input into the system accurately. And they're also responsible for sharing that data. So you will find different ways when Sudie continues this conversation on different platforms that data managers can share their data. In Stockton, we had an internal system within the school district where we were able to post student data on a drive so nobody else had access. The teachers also used Google, you know, to have their data team meetings and their professional learning community. So they definitely used Google, but the data managers need to be able to share that data with everyone, with the administrators, with the teachers, the counselors, and the transition specialists. So that's really, really important. Now the teachers, when they look at this data, they're really looking and analyzing their data because they want to make sure that the students have access and that they've created a lot of different opportunities and strategies for students to demonstrate learning gains. So that is the responsibility of the teachers. And I've already seen some things like data team meetings You know, that's really important that teachers meet regularly to talk about their data, share their data, and have time to review and analyze how their data can improve. And if you create that system at the beginning of the school year in Stockton in August, the teachers develop all of their data systems then so that at the beginning of the school year, they are able to continue on. They also have their data from the previous year and they're able to just import that data with them, because with the open entry, open exit, you'll want to be able to have access to data from the previous year. So creating professional learning communities was the best way in Stockton to take a look at creating their data teams. And then, of course, they went through a whole training session on how to do a data team process under the umbrella of a professional learning community. Our counselors and transition specialists are essential in making sure that the data and the conversations that they have with students are documented in the system that your agency is using, as well as making sure that your data goes to the next agency. So in this place, it would be San Joaquin Delta College. So there is a coordinator from Delta College who helps with this transition. And so they're able to share this data of students who are going from one agency to another. That was essential and critical. And then the other part is making sure that our students are part of the data system, that they are responsible for their own learning and that they know what their student assessment is looking at. You know, what does that look like? And that they have access to their CASAS scores, or they have access to their modules on EL Civics, or with their, whatever it is, with their GED prep classes, their high school diploma classes, or their ESL classes. You know, where are they showing evidence of learning? So you wanna make sure that you include all of these folks in your data collection process. Now you can start this at the agency level, and then you can expand it to the consortium. And, but you need to make sure that your agencies are comfortable and you've created that culture of data. I think that's really key. So thank you.
Thank you so much, Carol, for sharing your expertise and experience with leading data teams, developing those PLCs and data teams and things like that. We're going to transition a little bit into talking about the tools that we use. So really quick, before I jump into the tools I want to share with you, I want to know from you all, what tools do you currently use technology-wise to collaborate with your data teams or those you're sharing data with? And you can respond in the chat, or if you'd like to unmute and share, we love hearing voices and seeing people on camera.
Hi, Sudie, it's Peg from New Jersey.
Hi, Peg from New Jersey. I love Jersey. Go ahead.
Okay. So I just want to give an update, and I can give credit, full credit to Jay from CASAS for this. At our college in New Jersey, we use individual skills profile, personal score report, student competency report, and student content standards, all from CASAS TOPS Pro Enterprise.
Great. Awesome. Thank you so much. We're going to talk a little about those CASAS and TOPS Pro and TE tools in a moment. So I'm glad you brought that up. Wonderful. So let's go ahead and, Jay mentioned we'll be looking at all of those. We're going to go ahead and talk about some other tech tools that can integrate with those reports and things that you have. So one of which is really, it's actually the number one most commonly used platform for collaboration amongst colleagues, and that's Microsoft Office 365. It's cloud-based or desktop-based. You can have real-time collaboration. So if you're inserting your data reports into, say, an Excel spreadsheet or an Access database, you can manipulate that and share that with your colleagues at the same time and do that data analysis and looking at it in real time. It's also very, very data import friendly, like I mentioned. It's browser friendly too. So if you're using a Chromebook and you don't have Microsoft Office installed, you can still utilize it on the web. It has the ability for teams to collaborate directly within the same documents, including on spreadsheets, which is really big when you're looking at data. It has Microsoft Teams integration. So if you're having your data meetings through Teams and you're a Microsoft school, it's really cool to be able to be in Teams, demonstrate what you're looking at, and be able to see each other face to face and have a real conversation. Microsoft Office is also browser, Office 365, I should say, is also browser, computer, and mobile friendly. That means it works on Chrome, Firefox, Edge, Windows, Mac, Android, and iOS. If you're using Internet Explorer, I don't understand why, but if you are, you might run into some difficulties with Microsoft Office 365, even though it is a Internet Explorer is a Microsoft product, it's no longer being updated. So I encourage you to shift over to Edge if you really want to use a Microsoft browser. The interesting thing about it is it does require multiple applications to utilize the full suite of programs. So for example, if you have a presentation you've set up to share some of the data information, and you also want to be able to utilize the spreadsheets and other functions, you do have to have multiple applications to do that, unless you're using the browser front. It's also not free. So that's the kind of a downside to if you're using Microsoft, if you want to use Microsoft Office 365, but you're not currently an Office user. And so I want to show you kind of what it looks like on the front page of it. So this is just things I've been collaborating with colleagues on. This is an onboarding tracking ship thing that we use, and it allows us to kind of see where people who are coming in are at in the process, what kind of supports they're needing, and things of that nature. We collaborate on all kinds of things at CALPRO, so it's really helpful to be able to have everything in one space on the browser, even though I have other applications I can use too. It just helps me get to the most frequently used or currently being used collaborative spaces that I'm utilizing. So that's Microsoft Office. Then we also have Google, which is the second most popular cloud-based collaboration tool. I know no one is shocked by that. Google also allows real-time collaboration on a lot of different fronts. You can use multiple applications to utilize the full or mobile or mobile versions if you're using outside the browser. If you're utilizing the browser tools, then you don't have to download anything extra. But if you're trying to use it on your phone, which I do from time to time, then you do need to have all the different Google Docs, Google Sheets, all those things downloaded in order to use it. It is data import friendly though. You can import any piece of, any kind of spreadsheet or CSV file or things like that directly into Google Sheets if you wanna be able to look at that in real time and collaborate on it. You can also use Google Meet with your Google Sheets so you can look at your data and collaborate in real time. It's browser and mobile friendly. So it works on Chrome, Firefox, Edge, Android, and iOS. But remember, it's not desktop necessarily friendly because there isn't a separate application you download to your desktop. You do need to have an internet connection to utilize this. And of course, if you're collaborating on this, you want to be able to use it in a collaborative space, which requires online connection. There's no paid subscription. So you can use this pretty much for free unless you're utilizing Google Workspace or Google One. And all those really do is give you a lot of extra space for storage because there is a limitation on storage on the free version. However, you get a pretty good amount of storage for free. So you don't necessarily have to purchase anything and you can still use your data collaboration here. What I love most about Google is just the fact that it's so easy to get to it. You can simply go to, I am on the wrong page. Sorry, I was playing around with this. You can simply go to google.com, click this little icon here with your Google Apps, and you have all the tools right there at your disposal, easy for you to access. You don't have to go far and dig for it or look for it, including your Google Drive, which I was just on a moment ago that you can quickly access and utilize. I use Google Drive really regularly with the CALPRO team because that's how we do a lot of applications and tracking and things like that. And it really makes it easy for us to pull information externally without having to have access to SharePoint and our Microsoft products and still be able to collaboratively look at that data as a team. So that's also really convenient. So on to our next tool. This is Slack. We used to use Slack quite a bit before we switched over to Teams. So unfortunately, I can't show you my Slack spaces, but I can show you the setup in just a moment. Slack is really great for collaborative conversations and for being able to integrate into other areas. So it allows for sending of direct messages and files to an individual person or a team. It's not expensive to set up. It's actually the free version. You can add a bunch of different people to the team. It doesn't limit the number of team members you can have. There's no real-time collaboration on the documents, but there's a workaround for that, which we'll talk about in just a minute. You can organize conversations into various channels. So for example, let me show you what that looks like really quickly. So if I'm in Slack, I can set up channels so I can have things set up so I can have conversations with everyone. I can have specific people, in this case, group by interest, or I can just have a randomly selected group of people for whatever reason, if I was trying to do a social thing or something like that. But it lets you set up different channels. So if you wanted to make sure that only specific people had access to specific documents you were sharing, you can easily customize it that way as well and keep that into a closed group. It does support, yes, thank you, Richard. Slack is a great antidote to endless and confusing email threads. It really is. It really helps you really kind of group that conversation and make it really easy to navigate. It supports video calling. So if you want to have a quick video call with your team that's in that channel, you can do that. You can have file sharing. It's also compatible with other services. So in the event that you do want to be able to collaborate on a document in real time, you can leverage your Google Drive, Dropbox, or Box, which is also a file sharing source, in order for you to jump in there and kind of do the real-time collaboration while you're having your video calls. So even though it doesn't have it built in, it can be leveraged in other ways. The free version does have limited limitations, which include the number of messages it keeps and the file storage space. But if you're integrating it with something like Google Drive or SharePoint, Dropbox, or Boxdot, then you can easily get around that whole file sharing, that storage space issue. Additionally, it does clear out the number of messages after a certain point, which is kind of typical. A lot of our internal firewalls and security setup automatically delete messages after a certain date or after a certain amount of messages. So it works kind of similarly. There's no data import, so you will have to use a third party if you're trying to collaboratively look at the data and import it. But again, Slack is compatible with so many different products that it's really useful in that way. It's browser, computer, and mobile friendly. So it has Chrome, Firefox, Edge, Windows, Mac, Android, and iOS compatibility. The apps are super intuitive and very easy to use. So I really like Slack. We stopped using it because we switched over to Teams, but I still kind of like it. I think it's fun. And so I wanted to include it here. So let's switch to some kind of planning and process tools. So when you're trying to look at your data and you're setting goals, especially if you're doing SIP planning right now, and you really want to make your SIP SMART goals and SMARTY goals, if you're doing inclusion and equity, which I hope you are, that we're also thinking about the process of doing this, and we're setting actionable steps to work towards those goals. And so the next few tools I'm going to show you are really great for project planning to look at our data. So Asana is one that's really great for data project tracking. You can create a to-do list for ongoing projects and set reminders from upcoming deadlines and send requests to team members. So for example, if you're wanting your teachers to look at some specific data to identify areas of growth that they have, or say, for example, your individual PLC teams to figure out what their areas of focus are, you can give them a specific deadline to look at the data and get back to you on where they feel like their areas of focus are. Of course, you want to be involved in that conversation too and confirm with your own eyes, looking at the data that aligns with what you're seeing and that we're not going by assumptions. You can also use Asana to organize your data projects in list and board format, which I'll show you in a second. It includes a search function, which I find super useful because if you have a lot of data products going, or if you're the data manager or the administrator and you have teacher teams looking at data and doing their own projects, it makes it a lot easier to locate those data sets and those specific projects just by being able to utilize a quick search function. And it works way faster than our file explorer search functions that we have on our typical computers. There's no real-time collaboration, which is a little unfortunate, but you can integrate it with some other tools. You have to have other tools if you want to work collaboratively. So for example, you could provide a link to where the document is stored in your Microsoft Office 365 or your Google Drive and Google Files areas and things of that nature. So it can easily integrate, but the collaboration doesn't happen within the documents within Asana. There's no data import, but again, you would link it with your other tools in order to make it work. It's browser, computer, and mobile friendly. So it also works on Chrome, Firefox, Edge, Windows, Mac, Android, and iOS. So let me show you what Asana looks like. So this is Asana, and you can select your and have your different tasks and teams and things like that set up, have your to-do lists and things like that. I was playing around with this and notice I had my completion of my TDLS slides due by February 24th. I did finish that. So I probably should have marked that as, oh, I did mark it as complete. So I did that. It's all done. See? So then it disappears. But it's really quick and easy to use. Very intuitive. Doesn't take a lot of time to learn. And the free version does a lot. The one downside about the free version is the number of people you can have collaborating with you. If you're a small school, it's super useful because you don't have to have, you know, 10, 20 people in your data sets. But if you're a larger school, Asana may or may not be the choice for you, depending on your budget, because you do have to have the, you have to pay to have a lot of people added to your data sets and your data projects. So the next tool I want to talk about is called Trello. Trello is also really good for data project tracking, but I like it a little better than Asana because of its ingenuity with its compatibility with being able to pull stuff directly into it. It's great for project tracking, just like Asana, but, and you can also organize your spaces by teams or tasks or roles similar to Slack. So if you want to have all your things going in, grouping things based on who you want to have access to it and those kinds of things, that functionality is already built into Trello. You have the options to assign comment cards, which is a way to give feedback on individual things. So for example, if you assign something to one group, but you want a separate group to be able to give feedback, but not manipulate the data or play with it in any way, you can allow them access to comment cards that they can use to just give you some feedback. It's super compatible with a lot of different services, including Evernote, GitHub, Google Drive, and Slack. So if you want to be able to integrate things, it's really great. It has free version limitations, which include storage space and file size limit. It does not limit the number of people you can have on there on the free version. So that's pretty cool. The storage space and file size limit, again, you can get around that simply by linking to wherever you're actually storing other documents and then be able to get to it that way. So if you're using Google Drive, for example, or GitHub or Slack or Evernote, you can quickly and easily integrate that without any real difficulty. There's no real-time collaboration on documents, which is kind of unnecessary with Trello because it does integrate with so many other things. It feels like you're still within Trello while you're manipulating things, but you're really not. So while there is no real-time collaboration on documents within Trello, it does integrate really nicely for real-time collaboration on documents. It is, however, only browser and mobile-based, which means you either have to use it on your browser or you have to use it on your Android or iOS. But that's also, you know, not that big of a deal if you're trying to use this in a collaborative space. So I want to show you what Trello looks like. Also very user-friendly. So this is Trello, and what Trello has is all of these really cool ways to set up and look at the status of your different documents and areas. So you'll notice that on this particular project, the person is marked as blocked, and they have this cute little cat GIF. You can make it as creative as you want, but you can also have your to-do blocks, pending blocks, and things like that. And this is on my project management board. You can select a bunch of different types of boards, and you can customize who you want allowed in there. And again, what I really like about Trello is just the fact that I can add a bunch of people and identify who specifically I want to have access to things without having to break the bank. Another thing that I use, and this is one of my personal favorites, is Monday. Monday is another online collaborative project management tool, which allows you to have unlimited boards, unlimited work docs, which I'll show you what that is in a second, and real-time collaboration. It does a lot of things. It's data import friendly and compatible with almost all other collaboration data services like Microsoft, Google, Asana, Trello, and Facebook ads if you're using that for marketing and you're trying to look at your marketing data. So it's really great for integrating all these different things into one space. It has a very customizable workspace, which is super intuitive and really easy to use. It is, I cannot stress this enough, ridiculously user-friendly, very easy to utilize with no issues. The free version does have a significant limitation, however. You can only have two team members collaborate at the same time without having to spend extra money on it. So you want to make sure, if this is something you're utilizing, that you do have budget to add in extra team members if you're trying to use this as a collaborative space. Again, it's browser, computer, and mobile friendly. So Chrome, Firefox, Edge, Windows, Mac, Android, and iOS compatible. Super user friendly and works with so many other tools that it's really great to be able to integrate. And if you're someone like me who works on projects and various projects use different tools, Monday is really cool for being able to pull all those into the same space and to limit a little bit of confusion. So I really like Monday for that reason. And most people don't like Mondays, but I like this particular Monday. So let me show you what that one looks like. So if we're looking at my Monday workspace for CALPRO. We have some modules that we're updating, including our motivation and persistence for adult learners, to massage in the necessity to focus on motivation, persistence in online and blended learning. And that'll be piloting this summer, just in case anybody wanted to know. We're also updating our IET module too, to pull in some new resources. And so one of the items that we are stuck on here, it's not that we physically can't get it done, but there's some issues with 508's compliance. And so we're having our publications department look through everything to make sure it's 100% compliant before we move further any farther. And so we can see what was done, when it was done, and where we got stuck and what's happening there. And it looks like there's a new comment. And then our IET one, we are started working on it on February 28th. So that's where we are doing a content review. And then once we get further in there, we'll be able to do some more. We'll add in extra steps and mark things that are complete. It's just really intuitive and really useful for tracking and being able to utilize things. You can also add in so many different types of documents. And that when I said work doc, those are the different types of documents and dashboards. And you can also import your data from so many different locations. So if you have these data, wonderful data reports that we get from CASAS, we can totally import that so we can utilize that, filter it to figure out how many people are passing certain competencies and not others, identify equity gaps and those kinds of things. It is really, really super user-friendly. So I think that's why I like it so much, because anybody can kind of pick it up on one day and start playing with it and be able to utilize it. It's very user-friendly. So with that, I want to turn us over to Jay, who's going to talk with us more about what CASAS resources are out there and the different types of data you can download and other resources that are available to you that you can use within these collaborative spaces. I've uploaded the PowerPoint PDF into the chat a couple of times just in case anybody missed it. The links to all of this are included in there, so make sure you use those.
Okay, thank you. Great. So what we're going to do is we're going to cover two broad areas. Obviously, we only have so much time, so no, we won't go forever, but wanted to cover kind of the two broad areas, you know, covering a few resources related to, you know, curriculum management and instruction. Then we'll kind of turn it over more to the quote unquote hard data side and look at the data portal. And then we'll talk a little more esoterically about TE. You know, that's kind of, you know, 5 or 6 hours we don't have getting into all that, but I wanted to talk a little bit about how you might go about TE. So if you don't mind, Sudie, I don't know if you want to give me access or whether you want to just go to that webpage, your choice.
It's up to you. I've got it open for you if you
want to. Okay, go ahead and go straight. That'll probably make it easier for everybody else. So we're on the curriculum management and instruction here first.
This one?
Yeah, so go up to, just click curriculum management and instruction, you know, right where it says, yeah, right there, click that link, correct. Yeah, there you go, great. So this is the page I'm starting. So this is our CASAS website. So I guess, because we were talking through that a minute for a few seconds, I'll get everybody's foot on the rail. I assume we've all been here. I shouldn't assume too much, but has everybody here been to the CASAS website before? Yes or no? Do these guys look familiar to you all? Yes or no? Just kind of checking. All right. Thank you, Lorena. Okay. Looks like, you know, I'm seeing a lot of yeses. So great. So we've all been to the CASAS website to a large extent. That's, you know, because you've been there whether you like it or not. I'll say this is the section that perhaps you haven't been to, because this is the section that kind of is completely out of that like it or not part. We will go there here in a few minutes, but this is the section called curriculum management and instruction. To be clear, when you go to our homepage, there's a section called product overviews that you click. And then when you get to product overviews, you then select curriculum management and instruction. That gets you to this page. That's where a lot of our instructional resources are. Kind of the underutilized part of the CASAS website, so to speak. So what I'll do is, like all the other sections of our website, there's that list to the left of all those little blue breadcrumbs with all those typical categories. So I'll just sort of talk through the categories and then point out a couple that are of specific interest. So just going down the list, we have our two different kinds of content standards. You have what you might call the old school CASAS content standards from 10 years ago that are still embedded in our life and work tests. We've got the newer college and career readiness standards that relate to our goals tests. We have CASAS competencies that, of course, have been there since 1980. We have skill level descriptors. One that I'm not going to dig into, but one that has gotten a little airplay lately and is a, you know, one of the most underutilized CASAS resources, period, are our low-level literacy modules. That is, it's something we did with developmental services for adults with disabilities and or low-level ABE and ESL. Lots of resources to provide teaching, you know, using a lot of picture symbols and, you know, categorizing it by different, you know, survival symbols rather than, you know, requiring, you know, reading of text and so on. Then we will dig into quick search for a few minutes. That's another heavily underutilized resource that we used to promote a lot more than we do now. So we will look at that. Then sample test items, information on TE and some agency stories. So the one I wanted to look at first, I think, was that college and career readiness. I think that's one we discussed as a team that would be good. So this is what's new. You know, you can see it's been around for a while. I think the resource we use in our TE reports is 2016. That was when WIOA started. So that's when we're relating the official use of college and career readiness standards for all of adult education. On this page, it goes over a lot of information about those career readiness standards. And, you know, what we obviously, what we like to emphasize at CASAS is the fact that the college and career readiness standards are so closely related to content standards that we've been emphasizing for much longer than CCRS has been available. So we have some crosswalks that kind of allow you to link one to the other, you know, as well as, you know, how, you know, a lot of our CASAS system are related to those college and career readiness standards. So lots of good resources for you here. The next one I wanted to show is right below that, CASAS competencies. And so this is the oldie but goodie. We've had competencies, you know, since just about our inception in 1980. You know, a lot of you probably use these, but this gives you the everything you wanted to know and more about our competency system. You have the PDF of the official list. You know, there's content standards again. It gives you more information about those different content or competency categories, you know, and competency content areas. So you can dig deep here and get that list and look at more information about that. The final thing I wanted to touch on in more detail here is right below that, where we have, you know, quick search online. And so this is what I wanted to touch on maybe a little bit more than the other stuff here is we've got the links here to quick search. So I'll just stop here for a minute and just kind of curious, how many of you have used quick search before or are familiar with it, yes or no? Is this something that you've worked with before or is this a complete, you've heard it here first? Just kind of wondering. Okay, thank you. I see. Okay, so we're a mixed feedback. You know, right now it's looking split down the middle, about 50%. Yeah, thumbs down. About 50% yes, 50% no. So I'm glad there are a lot of no's because obviously that was why we wanted to talk a little bit about it. So this has been around CASAS for a very long time. It used to be called the Instructional Materials Guide many years ago. It was a big clunky binder that we updated every year that we use to present instructional resources. About 10 years ago, we got out of the clunky binder. For a year or two, it was on a CD. Now for the last 8 or 9 years, it's been on our website free of charge. You don't need to pay a dime for this. You do need to have a login account on the CASAS website, but you don't need to pay. But this has been a constant resource at CASAS because we, of course, they're more of like a smaller mom and pop organization. We're not one of the big guys like McGraw-Hill or Steck Vaughan or those larger conglomerates that have lots of money where they can publish lots and lots of published materials and training materials for, you know, relating instruction to their products. So we say, hey, we just are never going to be able to go there at CASAS. So we have the next best thing. We have quick search, where you can search for instructional materials. There's lots of different ways you can do so, but the most common way is, you know, back to what I heard Margaret talking about earlier, that is things like competency reports and content standard reports and TE. You have your students take CASAS tests, of course. You have those reports related to competencies and content standards that show you at the individual student or the class or the agency level some areas of strength and areas of improvement for your students. So once you get that information, as Sudie is demonstrating, you can find those specific content standards and or you can find those specific competencies that your students might need to improve in and find instructional materials specific to those competencies or content standards of need. So Sudie's selecting a sample content standard now. There's another page here where you've got that program level and skill. This allows you to further the search and kind of look by modality if you want only web materials or only old fashioned, you know, paper copies, whatever, you can select that. You can taper it for workforce or taper it to ABE or taper it to ESL, you know, different skills, of course, different levels. And so after you do that specificity, then of course you click quick search. I'm not sure what we had
my
here.
My search was too narrow.
We probably mixed and matched some of our different standards. I'm not sure what, but you know, okay, so try, there we go. So now you can see we select the specific competencies or standards, and then we refine our search by modality or level and so on. And we got a nice, neat and tidy little list here, you know, of all the different resources we might consider for that specific area of need. You know, if you click a random publisher, you know, anyone really, I was gonna say, you know, okay, that's fine too. You can click the title or the publisher and that gives you a little bit more information. You can see some of them have been around for a while, but especially you can see some things here, you know, things like computation never goes out of style, so maybe not a biggie, but you get specific, a big list of all the different standards and competencies they cover, some information about the publisher if you want more information about that publisher and so on. And the last thing I'll say about all of this is we don't just kind of sit there in our ivory tower and hand pick our favorites or whatever. There is somebody who works part-time that reviews all of these materials, kind of like an Inspector 12 or whatever. We don't publish any of our materials in quick search until, you know, that person takes a look at it and gives it kind of a seal of approval. Yes, this really is what they say they are. Yes, this really does, you know, apply to adult education and looks like it should be something that would be productive in an adult ed classroom. Okay, I'll just say any questions there, probably time to back out of that and move on to the next item here. So back to the slide, we'll go ahead and take a look at the CASAS data portal. So here's our segue. I guess I'm sorry to have you keep hopscotching, but if you can hopscotch to that link with the data portal, I'll just say I was kind of hoping, you know, we're right here where we're just about ready to post the most recent data from the 2021 year. I was really hoping that would be done. I gotta say, I was really hoping it would be done Tuesday when I did that statewide presentation with Carolyn. I was also hoping it would be done today, but 0-for-2. But nonetheless, we can still show it with the 1920 data. So here is the data portal. I'll back up a step. How many of you have been here before? Have you used the data portal before? Yes or no? Just kind of checking a little head count. Constantly, all right, okay. Thank you, Lorena, Elaine, anybody else, yes or no? I'm interested in those too, I'm kind of curious. Okay, some yeses, so sort of mixed feedback on the data portal, roughly 50-50 on this one, just like the curriculum management. So this is our CASAS data portal where we basically post end of year results from all we owe a Title II agencies every year. You know, we've got the top part I don't want to get into, but I'll just show it because it's on the screen, that California state, I guess you can click it, doesn't hurt, but this is not where you can get agency results, but it has our California statewide federal tables. You can see it goes all the way back to the inception of WEA back in 99, 2000. So you can look at all the Fed tables, including the ones we never really talk about and nobody really knows about. But if you're like a researcher and you just want the official documentation of how we did in California for a given year on any of these tables, you can do that aforementioned research right here. back, if you don't back up a step, please. But yeah, so, but what I really want to show is California Table 4. Yes, I know. So click California Federal Table 4 if you don't mind. So this is what it looks like. If you select Table 4B or the persister, the look and feel is basically the same. It's just the different data. Table 4, to be clear, is where we would go to look at performance for these federal levels. You know, persister is where we would just look to see what percentage completed a pre-post test pair, regardless of their actual performance. More on that later. We're not going to cover that here, but I will have a slide that refers you to this information if you want more of it. But just to stick with, you know, what's here, you obviously start by saying start here. If you don't mind, we'll just do a sample. We'll select agency. We'll keep the example as basic as possible. Let's just select ABC. Again, we can't get any more basic than that. And then we'll select them. Oh, wait a minute. I'm pleasantly surprised. I gotta say, I actually looked at like 7 this morning and this wasn't here. Some little angels looking out for me. Well, let's click and see what happens. Click submit, sorry, right there below. Yeah, I mean, I am what click submit.
I clicked submit it, that's when these bottom portions came up.
Oh, that's all that did. So click submit. Oh, there we go. Okay, it did. I'm sorry, I missed that. So, hey, there it is. Sorry about that. I made you do it twice just because I wasn't looking, obviously, or whatever. So you can see the 2021 is there. Thank you for paring down my error. Anyway, that's our 2021 data. So, hey, Elaine, you know, you're killing me. Well, they're killing me. I'm the one killed here because I'm saying we didn't make it. And, hey, I'm setting everybody up for failure when I should be setting everybody up for success, obviously. But there it is in the flesh. I'll just say that's what you can get. So I'll just say you can search by agency, by any of the 58 counties, by CDE region, by big or small, whatever. Pare it down to, you know, if you select agency, you've got a list of all the agencies. If you select county, you have a list of all the counties and so on. And then program year, any year from 2004-5 to now, 2021. And anything in between, you can drum up the data. So you can compare longitudinally. So if you want to look at your own agency every year for 5 years, go ahead, knock yourself out. If you want to keep up with the Joneses, hey, your LAUSD, you want to compare yourself to LACCD, or maybe your Oakland Unified. So you want to compare yourself to San Francisco City College or Riverside versus San Bernardino or whatever. You can do all those kind of comparisons with your neighbors, with your region, with your county, and see how you stack up. We've talked a lot about SIP goals, CAPE goals. This is the best resource, we think, to be able to do those sort of performance goals.
Jay, if I can just add really quickly.
Fire it up, please.
And at the very bottom, don't miss these downloadable files that are here that you can import into your collaborative spaces to look at with your team.
That's right. What Sudie brings up is there's that clip you can download to a CSV file or to Excel at the bottom, you know, if you want to kind of save it. Yeah, share with staff and do all of those great things that Sudie just said. And yes, Elaine, it's here. You know, we'll have more here later. Hold that thought for a sec. Let's do the last slide, though, just before, you know, before I forget, for goodness sake. So a little bit on TE. You know, there's a couple things. I mean, there is mostly just, I didn't want to dig into TE too much here because it did feel like 5 or 6 hours we don't have. There was a little bit of, hey, we want to access the data in my mind if that's how we're, you know, discussing it. And I do think that was the seamless way with what Sudie and Carol presented to talk about our website, not TE, but I will at least speak to it because it does feel a little bit like the pink elephant in the room or whatever. So, you know, what we say at CASAS is we really want you to have control of your data at the local agency. So fittingly enough, we have each agency manage user access. Is there an element where we don't really want to be responsible for all 400 or 500 TE agencies? Of course, we'd never get there from here if we had to manage it for everybody. But there is also a need for each individual agency to have, you know, 125% of the authority as well as 125% of the responsibility for your own data. So at each agency, you have, you know, that one, you know, data manager, you know, hopefully you have two or more, but you have at least one higher level manager that has that access and control to things like payment points and Fed tables and all those wizards for data submission and so on. That person decides with your management team how many people have high level access, how many people might have lower level access. So to tie it to what Kara was talking about at the beginning, we would say that's a perfect start for some of those staff discussions about how to manage data, who should have access at your agency, and to what level of access. What I'll bring, there's a lot of ways to do it, but I will cite one example. This is from a recent TE meeting we had, I think in January. Fabiola from Sweetwater did a video talking about those managing functional roles in TE, which is the term we use for different, you know, setups you can use in TE to enable administrators more access and or enable teachers more access, other support staff more access, and so on. So that's one video about how she does it. And at Sweetwater, they've kind of gone way out of their way as an example agency to make sure their teachers have access to the data and can review progress on her or his own students at that individual level. So I'll just make a plug and kind of tie it to that importance of having staff data discussions to talk about who has access and whether you want to, you know, be sharing, you know, that data by allowing more people more access to your agency's data. So I'll just stop on this one. I'll just say, anybody with any comments or questions, you know, including, you know, Sudie and Carol, of course.
No, I think you make a lot of really relevant points. And I think that's a discussion you want to make sure those who are listening that you're having with at your agency is who needs access to data, who needs what level of access to the data. Does that mean they get reports supplied to them electronically or in their boxes? I know some schools are still doing that. Or does it mean they need to be able to download their own data? And so we want to make sure that all staff that are impacting students have access to look and review data and are part of the ongoing data conversations from data managers, administrators, to teachers, and that are directly in contact with students. So make sure you're having those conversations. If you're a teacher who doesn't have access to your data, then go back and ask about how you can get access to it. That doesn't mean they have to give you complete access to everything, but at least get you access to your reports.
Thank you. Okay, so there's one or two more slides to try to kind of tie it up, I think. So this first one, you know, I'm referencing that presentation we did at the summit. There's one of those nifty slides when we did the reverse panel discussion. So a few of you, I think, are doing this for the first time, but there's a few familiar names where I think you have been at one of these previous sessions or at least heard us talk about it at network meetings. So we did that presentation at the 2021 CAPE Summit. Again, the reverse panel discussion where Sudie, Carol, and I kind of had you, you know, grill us in a way rather than the other way around. You know, we kind of went both directions, went inside out, kind of got a lot of feedback from you. You know, those were our two basic questions. It dug out a lot of feedback. There were a lot of areas of need, one of which was more resources. You know, that wasn't the only thing, of course, but we do think it was one of the biggies. So here we are at TDLS thinking this is the perfect opportunity to take care of this bucket. So we're bringing up online resources. There's also a panel we'll be doing sometime in April. You know, we'll be having a panel with best practices. You know, we'll focus on, I'll just for the easy way out, I'll say it'll focus on a lot of the things Carol brought up at the beginning. What are some best practices with engaging staff? You know, having more internal mentorship and collaboration. We'll have some panelists to address that. And then we're hoping to have something more interactive at the CASAS Institute. I admit we're still kind of chewing on exactly what it is, but we're looking to have something more face-to-face and interactive where we can start hopefully getting into more active, you know, working on mentorship and collaboration, you know, maybe externally across agencies, you know, guess I don't have anything past that. We'll have to see what that yields before we'll move past that. But I'll just say, I think, you know, if this works well, we'll hopefully keep moving forward after that as well. The one more is a little more same idea, but more brass tacks that are coming up. So the first one, you know, doesn't really relate to what we were talking about, but it does relate to data. That is the illustrious Employment and Earnings Survey. Hey, it is our official CDE action plan with Octe. So, hey, can't get more important than that. So we are going to be doing a training and a panel discussion next Tuesday there. The ones I mentioned for the 9th, 21st, 23rd called NRS performance goals, those are ones that I do. In particular, there's a couple sessions labeled part one that are the most basic ones where we get into the specific mechanics of how to access data on the data portal. There are other sessions where we do a deeper dive and talk about performance improvement at agencies, but I really wanted to reference those. So if you want more information about how to use the data portal, those will include sessions where we'll really get into that in more detail. We also have a panel on workforce collaboration here toward the end of the month. We'll be doing some goal setting things with CAPE on those dates. And then some panel discussions on, you know, like we talked about, one that will be creating a culture of data. We'll also have one that really focuses on student focus. We've got some really good panelists. We're kind of in the final process of confirming panelists for these two. So here in the next, hopefully, week or so, we'll have nailed down the panelists and we'll be able to post these. But gotta say, I've been talking to a lot of people. It's really shaping up good right now with some, you know, definitely some superstar panelists for these occasions. So I think it's 9:29. Hey, there's a minute left, so I better turn it over just in case. Hopefully a minute is all you need and I didn't need to have turned it over sooner.
Nope, that was great. Thank you so much, Jay. And thank you, Carol, both of you for bringing your expertise to this panel and sharing this information about why do we do this, the data that's out there and the tools we can use to look at it. Thank you both so much.